Online, our COD family online. We are in the downstairs tonight, so hopefully we got a little bit more light. We're going to go ahead and start with praise and worship, and then we'll go into the communion and then the offertory, and then we'll start the message. So we're going to go ahead and welcome Lana to come up and do some worship with us, and lead some worship. Thank God for worshipers and send in musicians and all those good things. So go ahead and invite Lana to come up.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks so much for coming and worshiping with us today and coming to hear the word. So if you'll just bow your heads with me quickly before we start. Father, we come before you, Lord, and we are so excited about today, and we are so excited about what you're stirring in our spirits, Lord. We are looking forward, Lord, to all those things that you have prepared for us, and that we are going to be able to taste and see, Lord, that you are good. We thank you, Lord, as we come and we worship before you, Lord, that we get to experience you, Lord God. We get to experience you in a deeper and deeper way. So we thank you, and we just want to worship you, and we just want to lift high the name of Jesus, and we are exalting your name in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. You are the life to my heart and my soul. You are the light to the darkness around me. You are the hope to the hopeless, the broken. You are the only truth and the way. You are the life to my heart and my soul. You are the light to the darkness around me. You are the hope to the hopeless, the broken. You are the only truth and the way. Jesus, you're the truth and the way. Jesus. My Jesus, my Savior. Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath and all that I am never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name, and I'll sing for joy at the works of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Jesus, nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Oh, Lord, nothing compares to you. Nothing compares to you. The sweetness of your presence, Lord God, and the glory, Lord God, that you bring, nothing compares to you. There is nothing in this world, Lord God, that could compare to what we have in you. We praise you. We sing to you, Lord God. We worship you. We seek you, Lord, in spirit and in truth, Lord. We lay down all that we are at your feet, and we come before you with a sacrifice of praise. There is nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord, let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let it rain, let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain, let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. I feel the rains of your love. I feel the winds of your spirit. Now the heartbeat of heaven, let us hear. I feel the rains of your love. I feel the winds of your spirit. Now the heartbeat of heaven, let us hear. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain, let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Oh Lord, we are so hungry for you. We hunger and we thirst after your righteousness, and we know that we will be filled. We thank you, Lord, for your spirit in this place, Lord, that is going to open our eyes to see and our ears to hear, Lord God, all that you have for us today. We thank you for a greater depth of wisdom and revelation, Lord God, as your word comes forth to us today. We prepare our hearts before you, Lord God. We prepare our hearts before you. We are open to what you have for us today. We honor you. We worship.
Well, welcome everybody. Welcome to be seated. You can see we're downstairs today. We're working on our communication. So if you didn't know, please let me know, and we'll be sure to try to get everybody. At least emailed and or something, so that we can make sure that you know we're downstairs and we just didn't not have a Sunday service. Let me fix something on my computer real fast. I had something pop up. Okay, here we go. All right. So we're still working on all the bugs. You know, sometimes there's something new every Sunday we have to fix, but we're going to go ahead and go start communion. So if you can, go ahead and start passing that out. Now bring me one too, because I didn't get one just a minute ago. So, we've been on a series talking about the, in our preparation time, we've been talking about how we're getting ready and prepared, and the Lord kind of took us on a journey, and then he's really been focusing on one thing right now, which is the growth process, or process of biblical growth. So I'll be talking more about that. All right, here we go. Thank you. All right, I'm going to put that right here. Sorry. But before that, we're going to go ahead and we'll take communion. I was asking the Lord, what to share today. And I just remember in my walk with God, and it might be different for everyone, but when it came to communion, it seemed like that's something I didn't do very often. And I found kind of a in my own personal walk with the Lord, I was in this place at one time where it seemed like it was really dry. The Lord was teaching me all these different things that we're going to be going through. This time that was really dry, I remember the Lord taking me back to communion. And it's just really interesting how I was asking for communion with the Lord and fellowship with Him. But then it came back to, taking communion. It was something that was far in between in my life as a practice. So I asked God one day, I'm like, Lord, I really want to really get to know you, and I really want to have more encounters with you and experience with you. And I remembered a man that I read a book. Anybody know Brother Lawrence? Ever read Practicing the Presence of God? He was constantly, in everything he did, practicing God's presence. And so I had read that book before, and I just remember the Lord saying, hey, when you practice your presence, include communion in with it. And I was like, all right. Because for some reason, when I began, and we're going to read this and I go through like I normally do, I always come back to this passage of Scripture to do communion because that's what the Lord took me to. So I do what I learned. And because I wanted to encounter the Lord, and he said to me about, I want you to start taking communion when you want to encounter me. All right, Lord, and he reminded me of Brother Lawrence, who in everything he did it for the glory of God and to encounter God. And at that point in time in my life, I hadn't really had very many encounters with God, and I wanted to increase those things. And so he brought me to this secret, I believe, of communion and encountering Christ, and something that is... In the book of Acts, you see they were breaking bread with one another. There's something special about this. Jesus Stephen talked about in the Gospels how he longed for this with his disciples. So I felt like in this time when the Lord said, I'm bringing you to myself, just like the disciples, called to himself those that he wanted. He began to take me through and began to share communion. That's where I started my practicing in the presence of God, where I began to... sit there and just believe that the Lord was with me. It was way easier to do that when I was taking communion. So I just wanted to share that little story before we start taking our communion. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, it says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took the bread." So let's take the bread. "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" So we're going to take the bread. Thank you, Father God. "In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes.'" So, Father God, we thank you for this blood and this cup. We just take it. Proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. And so, as I'm reading this here, it reminds me of another scripture the Lord was sharing with me in this communion, where he said, "Do this in remembrance of me." So Paul was admonishing Timothy to stir himself up in remembrance. There's something powerful about remembering what God does for you. And so we're remembering Christ. It's very easy to remember and encounter Christ when you're remembering things about him. So just a little, I believe, key in your walk with God, that if you are wanting to encounter the Lord more, set aside some time to encounter him and share some communion with the Lord. Remember him, what he's done for you. Your encounter with God will start to increase. And so I just wanted to launch you that. We're also going to take up the offering. So if you need an offering envelope, just raise your hand and we'll pass one to you. And I'm still on the same thing in my heart as far as excelling giving. You know, the Lord looks at the heart, whether it's 2 pennies or $1 million. It doesn't matter. He looks at the heart of matter. And so I'm going to read again as you fill it out and just getting that ready. 2 Corinthians 8:1-7. It says, "Moreover, brethren, we make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, that in the great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberality. For I bear witness that according to their ability, yes, and beyond their ability, they were freely willing, imploring us with much urgency that we would receive the gift and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints, not only as we hoped, but the first gave themselves to the Lord and then to us by the will of God. So we urge you, Titus, that as he had begun, so he would also complete this grace in you as well. But as you abound in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all diligence, and in your love for us, see that you abound in this grace also." So, Father, we thank you for everything that you've done for us. And, Lord God, whatever it is that we're bringing to you, Lord, that we bring to you with our whole heart, I'm just asking that you would just release, Father, just a blessing upon us, God, and even greater measures as we just come to freely give to you and to just love you with our tithes and our offerings. And I just thank you, God, for just energizing us, Lord, into this great blessing that we've become with you, that is better to give than is to receive. And I just thank you so much for this opportunity to give and to love you with our hearts. And I just pray over it. I ask you to just bless these tithes and offerings, God, that you would multiply it. Lord God, that you would begin to just move in power and finances for everyone that's giving here and online. And I just thank you so much, God, for what you're doing in this time and this hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go ahead and take the offering up. I'm going to go ahead and sing a little song as the offering's taken up, because I'm going through some of the things that we've been taught. So I'm going to just sing a quick song. The only one I really know by heart, sing it to my children. Lord, you are more precious than silver. Lord, you are more costly than gold. Lord, you are more beautiful than diamonds, and nothing I desire compares with you. Now that song's near and dear to my heart. In a lot of ways, my mother used to sing that to me when I was a child. And so, you know, you train up a child in the way they should go, and in the end, they won't depart from it. And so that was a song that I had all throughout my life, that song. And sometimes, you know, I look back at it, you know, nothing I desire compares with you. If that was a statement for part of my life and something that I've lived, it seems like there's nothing that I've experienced in life that has been better than the Lord. And everything, even the times when I have gone away from God and just searching, and I always would look back and be like, you know, I was always filled at my Father's house with him. And there's nothing more disappointing when you're a Christian away from God and the world doesn't taste good anymore, and you can't taste the goodness of God. And so that song seems to be something that would echo in my life, always turning my heart back to him. And so he's more precious than anything that we can ever do. So in saying that, we're going to enter in. I'm going to go ahead and pray over this word that we're going to have today. And then we're going to start in on it. So, Father God, we thank you so much for this wonderful word, the scripture that you've given us today. Father, I humble myself before you. I ask you that you would come and just show me some mercy tonight or today, and that you show us great mercy, Lord. Well, God, let your glory come in this place. Father, let every word that comes in as I begin to teach these principles and truths of your word, God, let it come and change lives. I thank you, Father, for your mercy and your grace. And I just ask you, God, also that you would just release a spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you, the eyes of our understanding being enlightened, that we may know the hope of our calling, the riches of your glorious inheritance in the saints, and your incomparable great power towards us who believe. Father, I thank you and I praise you that you have heard our prayer. You have heard us, God, and I believe that we receive it now. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we prayed and believe God is going to give some wisdom and revelation tonight, or today, kind of in the afternoon, sorry. So sometimes at night, you know, I'm trying to find the right words, but I wanted to start out because we've been talking about growing by the pure milk of the Word. That's all I kind of knew when I first started in this process. I heard a testimony about a man, Pastor Johan, who started moving into things of God, and he had this teaching about meditating on God's Word. And so I heard that, and I had been wanting to know how I could grow in the things of God myself, because it seemed like I would kind of be doing stuff all over the place, and I wasn't really getting results to the way I believe we see in the Scripture. And so I thought, well, I want to grow. I heard this guy's got a unique ministry, and every time I listen to something, it seems like I get something. So when he said this was the turning point of his ministry, where he began to meditate on God's Word for hours a day, and then he started moving the gifts of the Spirit, I thought, hey, well, why not, right? So I started to do it. And then I started to pray in the Spirit, as he was saying also in his Foundational Truth series number one, but also like just the meditating on God's Word that had these scriptures. I just read the testimony, and I was like, all right. From two pages of testimony, I began to do something that changed my life forever. And so I began to pray in the Spirit, and I began to read the Word for long hours out loud, not really quite knowing what was happening. And then over time, I began to notice a change. If you were to look at me in the Spirit, you begin to see fruit start to grow. I began to see fruit in my life. I'm like, wow, what is going on here? I was like, this is awesome. I began to experience overcoming the things of the enemy. Long periods of time in my life, I shared about my shoulder. I had struggled. I had dislocated it so many times, I stopped counting. I've been in a lot of pain in my life, and so one day I got a breakthrough. I got some healing. But before that time, I've been doing this meditating on God's Word. And I began to wonder, what's going on here? There's a difference. I don't feel empty anymore. I don't feel like I'm lacking something. I feel full. I feel like I can start to give things out to other people. I had an encounters start to happen with the Lord, and I was excited. I was starting to search what's really going on here. And so that's what I'm sharing with you. What is really going on? What is this growth process? And I got this teaching that I'm going to be sharing in a different way, but basically it came from Dr. Johan. It changed my life. Because when I begin to find out what God's Word says about what I was doing, if I was to say my meditating on God's Word had like 15 to 20% kind of faith behind it, once I started to get this revelation, my meditating on God's Word, my prayer and praise and worship began to come to a whole different level. It just was like, you got a big fire, you put some gasoline on it, That's what I felt like. I was like, wow, I see this. And then I began to meditate on God's Word. And it began to just grow and grow my experience with God. But I want to start before, we're in Ephesians. We're going to be in Ephesians. But before we go there, I want to read in 1 John, if you want to go ahead and turn with me, chapter 2. And we're going to focus on 12 through 14. The Lord actually had me in a whole bunch of these books for years. I would go over some of them every day, if not every day, every other day. I was constantly going through Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and then also God had me go through 1 John. And so we're going to read this here. And it says, I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write to you, little children, because you have known the Father. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I have written to you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. Now, this is giving a picture of growth. It's giving a picture of classifications. And, you know, as little children, we need to know our sins are forgiven for his name's sake. And then we'll go into fathers. But the other one I want to focus in on today is young men. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. And on Friday, I talked about the promise of the overcomer. And how we overcome by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony, love not our lives unto the death. And so I use some of these scriptures. And in verse 14, it talks about young men again. It says, I've written to you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abides in you. And so we last time talked about the power of the word. I shared with you a Greek word called kratos. And we're going to get into that more. It's been pretty powerful for me, but I'm a very visual person. And so when I was going through some of these truths, I began to draw some pictures out so I could understand them better. And so we're going to go and I'm going to draw some pictures out and we're going to talk about some of these Greek words. We're going to go over a few of them. But if you will, we're going to go ahead and turn to the book of Ephesians. If I can encourage you, and if I can implore you tonight, the book of Ephesians is one of those books that I believe is filled with so much revelation that sometimes we can miss it easily. And if you are going to spend some time getting in the scriptures, these six chapters will change your life. And it's amazing how much of God's word through the Old Testament to the New is in this book and explains mysteries and has so many different things in it. I've read it so many times and I still go back and I find things in it. I love it. And this is something the Lord has had me go through time and time again. And so we're going to share some of these different things. But the reason why we're also in the book of Ephesians is because what the Lord has been speaking over this church and what God's doing here is that we are like Ephesus, the church of Ephesus. It's part of our DNA. And so I used Acts chapter 19 as a model of kind of some of the stuff we're going through. But we're specifically going to concentrate on verse 20, which I'll just read it out. It says, the word of the Lord grew mightily and prevailed. And I shared last time that word mightily is the word kratos. And so keep that in the back of your mind. I shared a lot of different things last time, but we're kind of going to do a little bit of more of a recap, but I'm going to draw some pictures up here. We're going to go through some more Greek words and kind of I'm going to go through kind of an outline of the journey we're going to be on. And so let me go ahead and draw some stuff here. I talked the last time about the word, the spirit. And I'll be erasing different things. So if you want to take notes or you're welcome. If you need me to slow down a little bit, just let me know because sometimes I go a little bit fast. We have seen that there is many men and women of God that are strong in the Word or in the Spirit. Sometimes both. And when I came across kind of categorizing this, I remember looking at Smith Wigglesworth. You know, he was strong in the Word and the Spirit. And so as I began to grow. And let me make sure, am I still in there? No, actually, I'm not in the picture. Sorry. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Let me see if I can move it over a little bit more. Can everyone see that pretty good? I know we're trying to, make sure we got the camera going with my laptop, so it takes up a lot of real estate here. But can everyone see the board pretty good right now? Yeah. We position pretty well? Okay. All right, so we got the Word of God and Spirit. And last time I shared, I'm trying to write, so I'm going to move this over a little bit more. Sorry. So if I'm off a little bit, sorry about that. So last time I shared about four Greek words. So I'm going to draw another line here. And we learned about, a lot of people have heard about the Greek word exousia. A lot of us have heard about that. And we found out that's relating to authority. And I'm going to go through, I'm going to write all these Greek words down, and then we're going to go through what each of them are and kind of what it's trying to represent in the scripture, especially in the book of Ephesians. And then, and so we classify that under the word. And then we see this other word a lot of us are familiar with is dunamis. A lot of us are familiar with dunamis, the power of the Holy Spirit. Okay, we've seen some of the Old Testament men and women of God, but one of them, you see Samson, he comes and he rips his lion apart. You know, he's got the dunamis power of God working in his life. You see Jesus, and the lady with the issue of blood, she went and touched his garments, and he said, I felt power flow out of me. That's dunamis power. All right, so that's some of the word. This one right here, we find, I'm going to actually read this one out. We're going to go to John. I want you to see this one. John 1, and we're going to go 12 and 13. John chapter 1. Says, but as many as received him, sorry, did I give everyone enough time to turn there? It says, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So this is talking about the new birth, born of God. But it says, as many as received them, he gave them. This one says right. Some of them speak about power, but this word right there is authority to become the sons of God. He gave them authority. That's exousia. Look up in the Greek. Gave them authority to become the sons of God. And so there's an authority that we're going to learn about. But this is a correlation under the word of God. All right. Now we have two other Greek words that most people aren't familiar with. Sorry, I got this one a little dry. I got three markers and I got some spares in my bag, so just in case. All right, then there's another one here called Kratos. And then we're going to go ahead and I'm going to write this on here. It's another one. Now, some of us are familiar with this, some of us are not, but I'm just going to review here. Swordiscus. Now, I kind of butcher some of the Greek word pronunciations, and so bear with me if I'm speaking it wrong. But basically, we see that in the scripture, for the words for power, sometimes they're translated a lot of different ways, but we see exousia, dunamis, kratos, and ischus. And I had shared before, last time we were focused on Kratos, but I was sharing before about how Kratos represents the power of the word and how these two words are related, and it's under the word section, and then our classification. And then we see this the power of the spirit, but this is the power of prayer, and we're going to get into that a little bit more, but we see these are under the word spirit, and these two relate to the spirit of God. All right, so when you go through the Bible and you talk about someone strong in the word or someone strong in the spirit, these Greek words are going to be in relation to that. And so we're going to go through a lot of different scriptures, maybe not too many, but I want to kind of give an outline of what we're going to learn and what we're going to go over. And so I'm going to go back to Ephesians. So that's just so... Keep your finger there. I might turn some other places. Keep your finger in the book of Ephesians. Because there's two prayers in the book of Ephesians that we need to be very familiar with. And if you've gone through the meditation of God's word, some of the scriptures there, you find growing your spiritual man. There's these two scriptures are two passages of scriptures, one from Ephesians 1 and one from Ephesians 3. I'm going to read these out to you because we need to kind of have them in us as we're going through this. So we're going to start in this prayer at the end of chapter 1 in verse 15. I'm going to read to the end. It says, "Therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places." I want you to correlate this prayer with seeing Jesus raised from the dead and seating at the right hand of the Father. I just want you to keep that in your mind. Verse 22, "Far above all principality and power, might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all." Now, last time I talked about a framework and a structure. And so the Lord wants to build a structure in you so he can fill you with his fullness. And so that he can build something else, the fullness of Christ in you. All right? And so we're going to go now to chapter 3. We're going to read the prayer that he prays again. Now, these are powerful prayers. If you pray for them for yourself every day, you'll notice a change that's going to happen in you. And so we're going to start 3, verse 14. I'm going to read. "For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church, by Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen." Now I want you to concentrate on verse 20 here. "According to the power that works in us." A lot of times I was wondering why God, who can do everything, ask any prayer abundantly above all that I could ask or even think. This God, why wasn't it working? Why wasn't things happening? Well, and I saw this, and I hope you see it right now, and if you can, it's yours. "According to the power that works in us." So I realized I need to have some increasing power working in me before God began to do more than I can ask or even imagine. I needed something working in me. I needed some power. And so we're going to go through, and we're going to talk about these things through the book of Ephesians. And we're going to talk about, there's certain words here that we're going to see a wordplay on. Ischus and Kratos. We're going to see dunamis, and we've visited exousia. And so I'm going to go through and give a brief definition of each one of these so that we can have a little bit more background on them before we get in. Because sometimes when you're getting in the scriptures and you don't have any background and you start talking about these things, because I've gone through this teaching countless times now in my own life, and I've gone through these scriptures over and over and over. When I really begin to learn what these things do and what they are, when I go back and revisit the scriptures that have these Greek words in them, I begin to get more out of it, begin to come alive more. So we're going to talk about these words. So I talked briefly about exousia, which we correlate with authority. And we see it's working out of the power of the word. We're going to look at that. And it's, I got some definitions here. Delegated power, authority, power to act by virtue or position he holds, the right to act or use power. It's the right to act or use power. This exousia gives us the right. See, we have the authority to become sons of God, and there's a lot that goes with being a son of God. And so this exousia power, this exousia authority, we had read in John 1, 12 through 13, it gave us the authority to become the sons of God. Now we're going to look at Kratos, and we had shared a lot of different things about that. This is there the manifest power, dominion, might, power that is exercised or applied and hence which prevails, mastery or force. Now, I want to make another little thing here in this little chart that we have. All right? I want you to put next to this top section out. And next to this bottom section in. See, these words here describe in the Bible and what we're going to go over something that is working out of us. This is describing power that works in us. And so we're going to look and find out more how these things are working in us so that these things can work out of us. And when I began to see this correlation, I was like, huh, all right, because I've been kind of, when I would go through these scriptures, and I would go through and I'd draw these different things so I could get a better picture of it as we're going through, I find out put out and in. So you can begin to know what direction this is working first. All right? So we see out and in. Okay. And so now we're going to talk about the spirit side of these Greek words. Dunamis. Now, I'm going to give, the Strong's is 1411 on that. And let me backtrack a little bit. Kratos is 2904, if you want to go and look that up in the Greek. And then 1849 is Exousia, just so if you're curious. So we have dunamis here. So it represents the power of the Holy Spirit. It's an inherent capacity, inherent ability, power by virtue of one's own ability and resources. So those are some definitions, but we're going to look at the Bible to give us a better definition of some of these things. So that's the power of the Spirit. Right? It said how when the lady touched the hem of Jesus' garment, how power came out of him. All right, then we have ischus, which is 2479, and inherent strength. Strength as an endowment, strength that is resident in a person. And so we're going to look at this word a little bit more than this one, but I want you to see this chart here as we go. And just so you know, Acts 19, verse 20, we see, so the word of the Lord grew mightily, a Kratos, and it prevailed. We saw that special miracles were be done by the hands of Paul, and this is where we get this Kratos is an example in that scripture, Acts 19, verses 20. And so, as we've gone over some of these different things, I'd shared last time about the Kratos of God. We see that as the Word of God is growing, and those different things. And I'd shared about Jesus and John the Baptist in Luke 1:80 and Luke 2:40. And I shared about how we see in John the Baptist's life, and we see in Jesus' life, that there was a process going on. So we're going to visit this real quick as a kind of a recap. But we'll go to Luke 1 verse 80. It says, so the child grew and became strong in spirit and was in desert till the day of his manifestation to Israel. He grew strong in spirit. Anybody want to grow strong in spirit? I know I do. And so we see in the Greek here, the word grow is exano. And wax strong or grew strong is the word kratos. When it comes down to it, it's derived from the word kratui. This word is kratui here, but we see it comes from kratos is the root word. In spirit, wax strong and kratos in spirit, and was in the desert of the day of showing of Israel. Now that's John the Baptist, which some wonderful things have been said about this man. He was one of the greatest prophets, right? And so then we're going to turn to Luke 2 verses 40, which is the master, Jesus. there's anyone we need to be like, it's him. So we're going to see what Jesus did when he was young. And when I started seeing these truths, I was like, God, I got to know, what is it that you did? And so we see it in verse 40, and the child grew, Xano, and became strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. So he had something added to him. But that same word, strong, is Kratos. Kratos in spirit. And so when I was sharing last time about the power of the word, we find that Jesus was getting in the scriptures and he was growing, just like John the Baptist. All right. I also shared in Luke 4:14, before we move back to Ephesians, that it's just a few more pages over, 4:14. That Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and the news of him went out through all the surrounding regions. That word there for power is dunamis. So before this time in Luke, we don't see Jesus moving in dunamis power. We just see him kratosing, or the kratos in spirit. All right? Then we see him dunamising in spirit. So keep that in there, keep that in your mind as we're going. And so that's more of a little bit of an overview. But we have read in Ephesians 1 this prayer that's going on. So we're going to look at some, turn back to Ephesians 1. We're going to look at some of those Greek words in that prayer in Ephesians 1. And we're going to focus on... We're going to focus in this on a few scriptures here and go over them. And so we're going to focus on verse 19. And it says, so if you turn there, we're going to look at this by the different words in here. And does everyone have this down? Kind of. If not, I'm gonna make it a little bit smaller and put it over the corner so I can write some more things on here. So I was thinking how to go through and do these things. So I'm gonna make a little smaller chart so I can refer to it. Okay. Word, spirit, and we have exousia, which is the dunamis, kratos, and ischus. And then we're going to have O, I, which represents in and out. So it's kind of small, but if you can see it, that's kind of how I did that, and I'll refer to that. But I want to write this scripture out so you can kind of see. I'm pretty visual. So, I'm going to take a scripture here and now, can y'all, everyone see that right now? I'm going to move this next part of the scripture up on the top so I can reference this because we're going to be going over this a little bit more. So bear with me. Take this right here. Put it up here. So this is going to be recording. working. All right, sorry it took me a little longer to write that. But it's pretty, this is going to be pretty powerful. Okay, these are two words we see here, ischus and kratos, which is great mind. So I'm going to read this out and we're going to go through the words. It says, "And what is the exceeding greatness of his dunamis power in us who believe, according to the working or the energizing," which is the word energis, and we'll get to that a little bit later too, "of his ischus kratos," or his great might, all right, "which he energized in Christ when he raised him from the dead." Now, this is important. When we were reading through this scripture, it says, "which he worked in verse 20 of Ephesians 1, it says, "which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places." I didn't finish the whole scripture here. But I want you to see this, all right? "And what is the exceeding greatness of his dunamis power in us who believe, according," see that word, when I remember when I was talking to you, "according to the power that works in us" in chapter 3? This is "according to the working of his ischus kratos," or his great might, "which he energized in Christ," or he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead. All right. What I'm trying to let y'all see here is there was something working. The ischus and kratos was working here. This power, this great might, was at work when he did something. All right? When he did what? What was this doing? Well, when he energized in Christ, when he raised him from the dead. I said energize. I'm going to put the word worked here. Just so familiar. Worked. "Which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead." He was working something in Christ when he raised him from the dead. This is different than what he was doing in the Old Testament. This is something that's unique to the believer that has Jesus Christ in him. Remember how we read in Romans 8:11? Talked about the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you and will quicken, energize your mortal body, all right? So this ischus kratos is working in Christ when he was raised from the dead. This is working. This is something unique. This is part of the mystery that Paul is trying to explain to the church. Paul wants to get this revelation to us. And I love the way the Lord's been working. Because if you can see this, if you can see this mystery and know what it's doing and what he's trying to communicate, we can grow as sons and daughters of Christ in maturity like Jesus did and walk like him on the earth. This is a process that he's given to us in the church. We just got to get this ischus kratos, or this great might, working in us, because this is the same thing that worked in Christ when he was raised from the dead, right? Now, I didn't get to write on here because I ran out of room. But in verse 20, "and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places." Now, here's my question. Where are you? Are you seated with Christ in heavenly places? Let's look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. Because if you don't think you are, Maybe you're going to be one day. Because I remember talking to somebody at one point in time, and I remember sitting there, and I'm like, hey, listen, I found this secret in the Greek. And he's like, oh, well, that's really something for later. I'm like, what do you mean? Well, I just don't see how it could be, and I'll read why he said this, but I don't see how we could be seated with Christ now, because we're not there now. We're here. And I was like, it says, whether you believe or not or understand or not, and we're going to read what it says. Verse 6, raise us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ. See, we are two places at one time. We're here on this earth, and we are seated together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now, I have come to realize that people, my friend, and even myself, was not aware of this. Because at the time, I had a little bit of ischus and kratos working. I didn't have very much. I didn't even know. But if you can get this principle of these Greek words and what God is trying to show forth in us about the ischus and kratos, you'll become more aware as you grow where you're seated with Christ in heavenly places. And so this is where we begin to discover, whoa, he's trying to let us know something. This is what was energized in Christ. Now, if it was important for Christ, and we read in Luke about Jesus growing, he kratosed in spirit, grew strong in spirit. You can grow strong, you can kratos in spirit, you can be like Christ. But we're going to focus also today on ischus, and I had explained before how that's representing the power of prayer. Now we know Jesus was a man of prayer. He said, my house shall be a house of prayer for all nations. He made that very clear about his house. And let me tell you, you want to know what's important to someone, just walk into their house. You find out. We see with Jesus, it was important. We also see Jesus was a man of prayer. He prayed all night sometimes. He would go out. We see him in the Garden of Gethsemane praying effectively, fervently. So we're going to look at this word, ischus, because God wants to give us a revelation today. And so I want us to turn to James 5, verse 16. Now, if I'm going to erase this right here, well, maybe I'll leave it up for a second so I can revert back to it. But we're going to turn to James 5, verse 16. We're going to look at this Greek word, ischus. I'm going to turn here. James. Now, all right, here we go. 5:16. Therefore, or confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayers of a righteous man, ischus much, or avails much. That's that Greek word there. And we hear the prayer of a righteous man, ischus much. So we get this ischus in this passage in James 5, verse 16. We see this avails that's going on. We're going to look at a few more scriptures about ischus. Let's turn to 2 Thessalonians 1, verse 9. 2 Thessalonians. We're going to see another case. Now, if you want to do a study about these words, you're going to see more. We're not going to go over all the scriptures on these different things, but but we see they shall suffer the punishment of eternal destruction and exclusion from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his ischus power. So we're going to look at that a little bit more in detail a little bit later. But that's one of the scriptures about ischus. We're going to turn right now to Ephesians 6, verse 10. We're going to see some more play on Greek words. It says, finally, my brethren, be in dunamo, or strong, which means strengthened with dunamis from the inside, in the Lord, and in the Kratos power of his ischus might. You see another place here where there's this play on Greek words, ischus Kratos. Now, this is where I want to concentrate us on as far as ischus. We're going to turn to 1 Peter 4:11. It says, if anyone speaks, let him speak with as the oracles of God. If anyone ministers, let him do it with the ability or the ischus, which God supplies, that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belong the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. So we see this ability that comes. And the reason why we started off with James 5:16 is there is a prayer happening. There is prayer going on. The prayer of a righteous man. It's a powerful or effective in its working. And so, I'm going to read some more of these scriptures that I had. But we see that there's this ability in prayer that's happening through the ischus power of God working. And there's some other scriptures that are a derivative of ischus that I want to read also. I like this. It's ischeros, which comes from the Greek word ischus. And if you turn to Matthew, which is chapter 20, 12, verses 29, we're going to see another picture here. Sometimes I've heard of a picture of the strong man. It says, verse 29, or how can one enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man, and then he will plunder his house? Now, what I found interesting is if you look at the word strong man, right, in the Greek, it's this word ischus. Or else how can one enter into an ischus man's house and spoil his goods except he first bind the ischus man, and then he will spoil his house. Now this is a strong man. It's given some strength to it. And all throughout the Greek, you know, we're looking at a lot of different passages about that strong man, and I'm just going to read through them. Mark 3:27, and it talks about that strong man's the same word ischus or ischeros, but it's the root word ischus. Then we see in Luke 3:16, which we'll turn to this one. Luke 3:16. John answered, saying to all, "Indeed, I baptize you with water, but one mightier," that mightier, take a guess, "Iscus. One mightier, Iscus, than I is coming, whose sandal strap I'm not worthy to loose, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit, fire." So we see Jesus, he's got Kratos and he's got Iscus. John the Baptist recognized he's mightier than me, he's Iscus more than me. And so I'm going to stop there as far as that. We're going to focus, though, on James 5:16 when it comes to Iscus. Because what we're trying to get across here is this prayer that avails much, this Iscus. We see that there is the prayer of a righteous man that avails much. There's a power of prayer here. Then we saw last week how there was a power of the word that was working in Jesus' life. And I like to use Jesus as the model. So he had this. And then we find that Paul had found this. And he says, hey, listen, this power, this great might was at work in Jesus, was energizing Christ when he raised him from the dead. This Iscus Kratos was at work in him. And we're finding out as we look through that we see that we had Jesus strong in prayer and strong in the word. That power was in him when God raised him from the dead. And so, this is kind of how we're going to start this off, because we want to look more at this revelation that God is trying to get to us of this inworking of Iscus Kratos in Christ that raised him from the dead. What is so powerful about this? Paul want us to know this? And so, I'm going to erase this now. I'm going to erase this now because we're going to go through kind of an outline of the book of Ephesians so that we can begin to see what God is trying to communicate to us about this power, so we can start to do just like Christ, walk like him, be like him. I need to get some spray. All right. And so I had shared a little bit last time about Ephesians, and I'm going to go through here. See if I'm wrong. Okay, I'm going to go through here. So the book of Ephesians, we're going to do a little outline here. We have six chapters. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. I hope I can get everything on there. We have six chapters in the book of Ephesians. Okay, I shared last time that there's a division between these chapters. All right, these three want to show us something, and these three are going to show us something. And so I talked about how the first three chapters in Ephesians is establishing our position in Christ. We need to know that we're seated with him in heavenly places. Why? What is going on here? So we can have the fullness of God dwelling in us. You see this seated with Christ in heavenly places. And then we see this theme about the fullness of God dwelling in us. So these three chapters are about establishing us in Christ in us. And that we are seated with him. All right? These next three chapters, 4, 5, and 6, teaches how to walk in Christ, how to walk in love and faith, and it teaches us how to exercise our position in Christ. So I'm just going to put right here, just walk. Christ. Before we can go out and be successful in spiritual warfare, we need to learn to sit in Christ first. We need to learn who we are in Christ. And we need to have Christ and that fullness in us so that when we go out and we begin to walk and do the things that God's called us to do, we can do it the way God called us to, just like Jesus. And so when I went through this study and I began to see these, or begin to learn these different things, the reason why I'm letting you know what these divisions are is because I'm going to go through we're going to break down each chapter so when we go to walk through it, we know what God wants to communicate to us. So as this week you're going through and you're reading Ephesians, you'll begin to see some different things. So when we get together next time, we're going to build on it. We're going to go into things in more detail. Because when I begin to see these things, every time I got into the Word of God, I began to know what was working in me. Every time I began to pray in the Spirit, I began to know what was working in me. And I began to see and experience things begin to accelerate as I knew what was happening. And so in Ephesians chapter 1, it's kind of hard to write on the other side. I'm right-handed. So in Ephesians chapter 1, we're going to see that every chapter is going to represent something about Jesus. And it's going to represent something that we need to know. Now, we're not going to do this big, long study. If you've been born again Christian, sometimes you've heard about these furniture pieces in the Old Testament. All right? And so I'm going to go through and I'm going to write down a few of these things so we can know what's working and what's trying to be explained here. All right? In chapter 1, it's correlated with the brazen altar. And then in chapter 2, we see it's correlated with the labor. Chapter 3, it's correlated with the table of showbread. Chapter 4, it's correlated with the candlestick. Chapter 5 is correlated with the altar of incense. Sorry. And then 6 with the Ark, the Covenant. And I like to refer to the Ark of the Covenant as the mercy seat. Sorry if you can't see. Let me move some stuff over here. Maybe next time I can find another one that's a little bit this way. Sorry about that. But let me go over here. So we see that there's these themes of the furniture pieces. Now we know that these things were types and shadows in the Old Testament. And everything was representing Christ. So we're going to go into these different things of what is trying to be explained to us and what's trying to be revealed to us in the book of Ephesians. Now, I think I might have spelled that wrong. Altar. Okay. All right. So everything is representing something. Now, I hope I can put this all in here. But the brazen altar, we're going to spend some time in this one. But I had talked about last time, we overcome by the blood of the Lamb. All right? And not last time, but let's talk about Friday with all my prayers. So the blood of the Lamb, okay? And this is representing the Lamb of God, Jesus. Jesus, the Lamb of God. So I'm trying to figure out how to write it. Jesus, the Lamb of God. And this is also explaining to us the power of the blood. So in chapter 1, we're going to see it's correlating with the brazen altar. And And it's Jesus, the Lamb of God, is what we're trying to learn about. And it's going to teach us about the power of the blood. Okay? Now, in this power of the blood, okay, I didn't go too much into it on the overcomer promises, because it says we overcome by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony, love not our lives unto death. All right, the power of the blood, what we're trying to learn about it is redemption. All right, and it's the doctrine of the justification of faith is the revelation that we're trying to get here. All right, let's see if I can put that on here. Okay, and so when we're going, we're going to see this theme in chapter 1 about the brazen altar, the power of the blood, this return or this revelation of the justification by faith, because we have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And it's given us something, all right? Then we look at the laver, and actually I'm going to go ahead and talk about this a little bit more, before I go to the laver. This is also giving us a picture of revival of Iscus, all right? So I'm going to put that on there. We're going to go into more of these in detail, but I want to do this overview. Okay? So in the labor, this is one of my favorite ones. I have many favorite ones, but this is one of my favorites, revelations that God's given to me. As far as like one of those ones, when I hit it, I was like, whoa, I love this one. It's Jesus, the Word. And so, this is represent Jesus as the Word of God. He's the Word made flesh, came and dwelt among us. And this is representing the power of the Word. And more so, it's giving this picture, and I'm not going to be able to write this on there, because the Word is in us. We're in Christ. We abide in Him by the Word. All right? We're in Him through this Word, this abiding Word. And this is given a revelation of this, the revelation of the spoken and the written Word that has come back to the church. Sometimes we've lost even justification by faith. We've lost the Scriptures at one point in time. Unless you were a priest in the church, you couldn't have a Bible. And then one day, we get this printing press and we see the Gutenberg Bible come again. And so there's that's part of in our history, something that this is also given, is this revelation of the written and the spoken word, is what this labor is giving us. And so when you have the labor, you know, and you come and you wash, talk about Ephesians, washing by the water of the word. So there's different themes going on here. So that's the labor. It's getting us the power of the word and the revival of Kratos. All right? This is the revival of Kratos. All right. So in chapter 1, we see basically the revival of Iscus. Chapter 2, we see the revival of Kratos. And these are represented in the brazen altar and the labor, the power of the blood. Power of the word. Then we're going to see, and by the way, we're going to also note that these two chapters are correlated to one another. They work with one another. It's hard to really separate them apart. And I shared before about the Iscus Kratos, the mighty power that was working in Christ and raised him from the dead. All right, we're going to see that in this chapter that he explains to us about something that happened to Jesus. See, he was raised from the dead. And then in this chapter, you see that something that happens to us, that we were raised and seated with him. It's powerful. Now we're going to go to the table of showbread. This is given the revelation of, or this is given Jesus Christ. JC, just because I don't have very much space. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. This is where we see, let me underline here, the power of the name of Jesus. The power of the name of Jesus. And we see, as far as the revelation goes, see if I can get this in here. It's the revelation of the authority of the believer. On here. So the revelation of the authority of the believer. So I kind of am breaking these out, basically, where we see the furniture piece. We see what Jesus is trying to be represented in this furniture piece. We see what power is trying to represent that was given to the church. And we also see the revelation that was given that correlates with that power. That's kind of how this has been broken out, broke down as when I went through and I was learning about these different things. Because if you asked me before this time when I got this revelation in Ephesians what anything really meant about the brazen altar and Jesus, I was like, I don't know. But when I began to see what was going on with all these different pieces of furniture, when I began to see what was going on with all these different pieces of furniture, I began to see different things about what Jesus was trying to communicate. See, the Old Testament was a type and a shadow. It was trying to tell us something about Christ. All these things. And then when I began to understand, well, what is this representing and what is it trying to get to me? The power of the blood. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb. The word of our testimony. We love not our lives unto death. And we see, careful. I'm going to move the camera just a little. There you go. Thank you. We're going to see, I'm going to move back over here. Yeah, because I can't write the other way. I'm right-handed. Sorry. I began to see these different things as I was being taught through the things that Pastor Johan was getting to me. And I began to see what was going on here, what was trying to be revealed to me so I could walk in it. If we don't know what's ours, we don't know what belongs to us, we can't walk in it. Remember one time, you know, it's like, well, we just take authority. I was like, all right. So I just would take authority over certain situations and nothing happened. It seemed like I'd be like, well, where'd my authority at? And so I began to be taught how we can walk in each one of these things, in each one of these chapters, we're going to see something. These revelations are going to come to us and back to the church. We're planning for God to do a great work here because he said so. And so we're getting everything ready. This is a revelation of growth because there's going to be a lot of people that come in that don't know anything about the Bible, don't know anything about anything, just, hey, I heard about a man that came to save me. Sometimes all we know is Jesus came to save me. But he doesn't want to leave us there. He wants us to grow. Exano. So we're going to concentrate on these different things. So we're back on the table of showbread. And so Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the power, the name of Jesus, the revelation of the authority of the believer. And this one's powerful because it helps us know our rights and our privileges in Christ. It helps us to see the power of the name of Jesus so that we can exercise authority over demon power. See, we have been given the authority to become sons of God. A son of God gets to operate with Christ to do the will of God on the earth, just like Jesus. We got to know how to exercise this authority on the earth. We have to understand that we're risen with Christ and we're seated with him in heavenly places. so that we can know who we are as a son, far above all principality, power, might, and dominion, and every name that has a name has to bow down to the name of Jesus, the authority of the believer. Then we see in chapter 4, the candlestick is the representation of what God wants us to see. And we see in this one, sorry, let me get down here, Jesus Christ, the baptizer. Of the Holy Spirit. We're given some. we see that, you know, the dunamis power, baptizer of the Holy Spirit. And so we see the power here. The power of the Holy Spirit. That dunamis at work. And this goes into the revelation of the Holy Spirit. The revelation of the Holy Spirit of God. And we see that in chapter 4 of Ephesians, that there's gifts given. We see ministries and offices of the Holy Spirit that is given and it's imparted to us. Of the anointing of, through this anointing of the Holy Spirit that's done. And we see that there is a revival of dunamis. That's the revival going on. The revival of the dunamis power of God, the gifts and the ministries of the Spirit of God, is going to be explained to us, and we're going to visit that. Now, there's other places in the Bible where Paul references these things in different detail, but this one kind of has a culmination of all these things that are for us. So that we can begin to exercise and walk in Christ, our authority here. Because there's sometimes when you have the authority to do something, you just don't have the power yet. See, you have authority to become sons of God. But we need that power to work. So that when it comes to the place, that dunamis power, just like Christ, will flow out of us. People will get healed. We cast out devils. We do these different things by authority and the power of God. So we see that chapter 4 represents this candlestick, Jesus Christ, the baptizer of the Holy Spirit. Because I like what John said, there's one that comes after me that's greater than I. And he's going to baptize you and the Holy Spirit in fire. Or Holy Spirit in power, sorry. I'm sorry. Thank you. Sorry. Benjamin is helping me out. Our trainee deacon over there, so helping me stay in the picture, because sometimes it's been hard to learn how to stay here, because I like to move around and write and talk and stuff, so he's got his phone there to help me out. Thank you, Benjamin. All right. Because Lana's like comes out and says, hey, can't see ya, you know, so okay. And so we see also that these two chapters are going to be correlated to one another. It's going to be hard to separate them. See, the power of the name of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, that you've given us wisdom and revelation and that people are going to want to read their Ephesians Bible about the church of Ephesus and what was going on there. All right. Chapter 5, the altar of incense. Now, I like this one, too. What can't you not love about Jesus? But Jesus... This one here is Jesus Christ, the high priest. The high priest. Oops. Next time I'll figure out a better way to put this. But for now, this is what I got, so I'm working with it. Praise the Lord. All right. And this is showing to us, we'll underline the powers here. The power of prayer. Oops. Praise and worship. Altar of incense. We see the fragrance of Christ, the return of the Lord, and the glorious, the glorified church. All right, these are powerful because I wasn't necessarily going to share right now, but I feel a little bit led, is we've been talking about this 24-hour praise and worship that's coming back. We've been talking about this new Jerusalem glory. I believe this is going to flow. And actually, if you've been watching Dr. Johann Lahn, he's talking about these pristine angels that are coming to help us enter into a higher dimension of worship. This is so important. This is a revelation that God wants to give back to his church of the power of prayer, praise, and worship. I believe that in this time of these end times that we're going to have to really come to a new understanding, because God wants to reveal a whole new level of prayer, praise, and worship. A whole new level that we've never encountered before in this time. We're going to encounter worship at a whole different level. And so we're going to see, even I believe in this chapter, this allusion to these things that are coming to the glorified church. It's pretty exciting. Because we also see in this one, there's the washing of the water of the word. We see the relationship between husband and wife. But not just as a, oh, this is only husbands and wives, but representing Christ in the church, the glorious bride. See, the bride of Christ is going to enter into some new levels of worship. It's going to be powerful, and a new Jerusalem glory, all those things are going to come through that. But we got to know who we are in Christ as his bride and operate in that. And so this is given the revelation of prayer and the revelation of worship. So again, you know, this is a revelation that we need to have of these things, prayer, praise, and worship. But this one, prayer is really given here, but this one's going to focus on the revelation of praise and worship that's going to happen. Then we have the mercy seat, or the Ark of the Covenant. And this represents a little bit different aspect, but the fullness of God. In Christ. See, Christ represents all the fullness of God. This represents the fullness of God in Christ. This fullness. And the power here that's going to be at work is the power of the presence of God. See how I'm doing here? Taking a little bit of while to go down. It also speaks about the armor of God that we need to have on, which this armor speaks about the fullness of God working in our lives. When you got the fullness working, put on the whole armor of God. All you got to do when you're done is stand. Having done all, stand firm. And that we have read about that in Ephesians chapter 6, Ephesus. Sometimes I go back and forth with that, but Ephesians chapter 6. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. So we find that Iskus Kratos going on, and we find he's putting on the armor. And then we'll go through a lot of these different things, and having done all, stand. Verse 13. And so we're going to see this fullness done in Christ, and we're going to see how God is moving in every one of these chapters to reveal not only who he is, not only the power available, because in Ephesians 1, we're supposed to know something. What are we supposed to know? The hope of his calling, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and his incomparable great power. All these different aspects of his power, his great power to us who believe. See, God doesn't want to leave us powerless. I love this scripture because it applies in so many ways. John 14, 18. I will not leave you as an orphan. I will come to you. See, he's coming to us. He's coming to do something. He's coming so that we can grow up, that we can be like him, and we can walk as he walked on this earth. Because there has to be this prayer fulfilled on the earth. It says, "My Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on this earth as it is in heaven." I also want to let you know that there's a correlation between these two also. And we're going to have a fun, exciting journey going through finding out about all these different things. Now, I wondered and I was asking God when I was going through, because this is a lot. And if you ever sat through a lot of different teachings of Pastor Johann, even though he will go through many sessions on these different things, he cram-packs us with so much stuff that, you know, me not knowing many of these things, I had to go back and I had to go read about the brazen altar and the laver and all the table of showbread, the candlestick, the altar of incense. I had to go back and find out more about what the Old Testament said about it. But I believe when you get this revelation and we begin to put these things together, that when you do go back, you'll begin to find things you've never seen. And it will begin to come together. What was he trying to show us then? Oh, this. He's trying to give us these revelations. And as you meditate on this stuff, it will get in you. And it's interesting how God builds on different things. And so you notice that, you know, Thursday night I'll teach on something and kind of tie it together to Friday night and try to kind of get it to Sunday. And so if you wanted to know more about the power of the blood, you really need to find out about what's happening with Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, his brazen altar, and the revelation of the justification of faith. And how we are redeemed. That's the power of the blood. Because when you've been washed in the blood of God, when you've been redeemed, Satan has no power over you anymore. There's so many different principles given here, but I want to talk about this power of the blood of Jesus, because I didn't get to talk about it very much the other night, and I feel like the Lord wants to pinpoint in here. We are no longer subject to the law of sin and death. Did you know that? We're no longer subject to it. We'll turn to Romans, because I want to read this real fast. I wasn't necessarily going to plan on doing this, but as the Spirit is wanting me to zoom in here. If you read at Romans 8, you'll notice something about sonship going on. So I'm going to read chapter 8. We're going to go through here and all the way to 11. It says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who were in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death." It's the power of the blood. "For what law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin. All right? But the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." And I want to skip down to verse 14. It says, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God." We see that we are no longer under the law, subject to the law of sin and death. We have been made free, in verse 2, from the law, by the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. This all starts out from the brazen altar, the revelation of justification by faith. What's interesting here, as we see in verse 11, that this Spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you, will give life to your mortal body. Now, I talked about in Ephesians 1:19 how we see this Iskris Kratos at work in Christ, who was raised from the dead. All right? This Iskris Kratos needs to be in us so that we can begin to experience all the things that he's given for us when he raised Jesus from the dead. See, we find out what Jesus did in chapter 1. He's going to summarize this. And then we're going to find out what he did for us, chapter 2. See, he raised up Christ from the dead. And then chapter 2, then he raised us up. We're going to find these different things. And honestly, when you begin to study all these different things, when you begin to read back through Romans or other things in the Bible, you're going to say, uh-oh, wow, this isn't... Paul was talking to me about this already. You begin to correlate all these different things together. You begin to see how they work. This mystery of Christ, the mystery of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I love Paul said that. On one thing, Jesus Christ and him crucified. When I was curious about this statement, I'm like, Jesus Christ and him crucified, what more is there? You know, like, I didn't really know. You begin to find out in Ephesians, there's so much more. So many revelations about Christ, the power of the blood, the power of the word, the power of the name of Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of praise, our prayer, praise, and worship. These powers at work, the power of the presence of God, the mercy seat. And so if you bear with me a little bit more, I have a little bit more to talk about before we close today. Because if we can get this revelation, if we can just get it, not only just get it for us, but get it so we can give it out to the body. Because there's so many times I cried and asked God, why is it just not working? What's going on here, Lord? It seems like I've done everything I know to do, and yet I fall short. And when I got this revelation of what God wanted to give me, and I began to exercise it, I began to grow in the Spirit, and then I realized this is what God wants us to know and wants us to do so that not only can we get help for ourselves, walk in victory against the enemy, but so that we can do something and help the body of Christ and help set the captive free, proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. There's someone out there who's waiting for you to grow into a mature son and daughter of God, so they can be set free, because you're going to go preach the word in power. That's where we're going. And I believe that God wants to do that for everyone here and everyone watching online. We're going to grow together. We're going to experience the power of God. Not just that, we're going to experience the glory. If you only believe, if you can only believe, you'll see the glory of God. This move is coming with the glory of God like we have never seen it before. And so we need to come into some wisdom and revelation about this glory that's coming and the glory that's already available to us. And so I want to go to the next thing we're going to talk about as we've gone through all these different points. We're going to learn about how we're seated. We're going to learn about how to walk in Christ. And then, we see that... there's something going on with this energizing or this Iskris Kratos, because what Paul was praying in Ephesians 1 was that we would get wisdom and revelation for a reason. He's praying specifically about, we're going to turn to that because I want you to see it. If you can see it, it's yours. I love that about God. You can see it, it belongs to you. If you can see it. Take a step back, the lady with the issue of blood saw Jesus a certain way. If I could only touch the hem of his garment, I'd be healed. She saw that he was the healer. she could just tap into that, she would get healed, which she did. But she saw something because she heard something. We see that in verse 17 of Ephesians 1, that the God of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, is praying may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding. And that actual word is the Greek word dianoia, which if you look in the Old Testament, the other Greek word there, or the Hebrew word in the Old Testament is yetzer. Which if you've gone through a series of visualizing in the spirit, you begin to know a little bit about the dianoia and the yetzer as part of our imagination, but so that we can see something. We need to see it. And so that it'll be enlightened or flooded with light, that you may know, and it talks about the hope of his calling, the riches, glorious inheritance to saints, the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe, according to the working of this Iskus Kratos, that which worked in Christ. He wants us to see what was working in Christ so that we can begin to know these things and walk as he walked, raised from the dead, seated at the right hand in heavenly places. And it goes on far above all principality and power, might and dominion, and every name that is named. And then how he put all things under his feet. And this is important. And he gave to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. See, we're one with him. We're over all principality, power, might, and dominion, and every name that is named, because we are seated with him. We are one with him. So Paul wants to have this wisdom and revelation given to us, our eyes opened, so we can know that how the energizing of Kratos works, how the energizing of Iskus works on our inside. See, it was in Christ. This is in us too. This is available. This is one of those things that wasn't available in the Old Testament to Old Testament believers. But now that Christ has risen from the dead, this is what raised him. This is what dwells in us. This spirit that is energized by Iskus and Kratos. The power of prayer, the power of the word in us. And then we see that in Ephesians 3:16, turn there real fast, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened, or with might, strengthened with dunamis. Dunamis with Kratos through his spirit in the inner man. Sorry about that. So we see that there is this power through the word that is in operation here. This is important for us to know, because sometimes we've seen people who have the power of prayer working. And we've seen men and women of God who have tapped into this power of the word working, and there's mighty things done. But we also see people tapping the power of prayer, and then you see this working of the dunamis power of God, and there's miracles and there's signs and wonders, but then something happens sometimes. We've heard about men and women who fall away or they burn out. We see this iskus and this dunamis happening, this power working. We see people praying and there's all these mighty things happening. Some happen, they burn out. So Paul's like, hey, listen, I want to help you out here. You need to have the Kratos in you so that that dunamis will stay with you and you won't get burned out. There's a strengthening in your inner man that is happening so you don't get burned out. And then we also need this working of the dunamis power of God so that we can do the works of God. But if we don't have what I call the character of God working in us, it's only a matter of time when that dunamis power will begin to fall off of us. And we're going to look at some things too, because these two things, Kratos and Iskus, and I read a little bit earlier about a glory. We're going to turn back to 2 Thessalonians 1, verse 9. There's a glory that is happening with this power that is working. It says, these shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his Iskus. See, there's a glory that comes through Iscus. Now we're going to see a glory that comes through Kratos. Let's turn to Colossians 1:11. Strengthened with all might according to his glorious Kratos for all patience and long-suffering with joy. See, there's a glory that comes through prayer, Iscus. And there's a glory that comes from the word, Kratos. And we begin to see these things at work that come, when they come together. Now, for example, we see in Luke 11, the transfiguration. And it said in Luke about Jesus, as he prayed, he was transfigured. There's a power and a glory of prayer. Because we see in 2 Corinthians 3:18, as we behold, we become from glory to glory. From glory to glory. So as you begin to exercise the power of prayer, the glory of prayer begins to operate in your life. That transfiguration type glory. And we see the glory that comes from the word. We see that operating in Jesus, that Kratos strengthened in spirit. You see these glories at work. And there's these two rivers that are going. Now, the reason why these things are happening, these glories are working in us, is so that we produce fruit. It's not enough to just work in the power of God. We got to be like him. We got to be like Christ. And these things, the Kratos, the Iscus, are working in us like it was working in Christ, who raised, when he was raised from the dead. And I just want to share, you know, some stories. You know, I couldn't get breakthrough in certain things in my life. Anybody, you know, have a problem with patience or a problem with kindness or a problem with whatever it may be? I couldn't get free. I was under the law of sin and death. It's like, Lord, I can't break free. But I see that I'm supposed to be free. I see that these things should not have power over me anymore. We talked about that strong man, that power. But it says when the one comes stronger, has more iscus at work, he binds that strong man. Now, we have the law, the spirit of life in Christ Jesus available to us that makes us free from the law of sin and death. When you begin to get the Kratos and Iscus working in you, you get to get your mind renewed by the word of God. You get to have that glory of the word work in your life. Then you get to have the Iscus of God working in you as you begin to prevail in prayer. You spend time with him in prayer, and you begin to be changed from glory to glory. What begins to happen is you begin to get in tune with him. And I remembered when one day something happened, and it just didn't bother me anymore. I wasn't moved. It's like, all right, well, we'll just deal with it. Before, I'd be like, oh, man, my world is falling apart. I'm so angry. I'm upset. Why did this happen? But I began to know my position in Christ. I began to grow in these things. I began to understand the power of the blood and how I'm free from all sin and death. Not just through I understand a lot about it, because I did. I read certain things about being free from sin. I just never really was. I began to get free from the law of sin and death. I began to operate in the law of spirit of life of Christ Jesus. And I began to know the power of the word. I began to know the power of the name of Jesus. These things begin to just flow as I began to grow in the word of God and Kratos of God in my inner man. And then when I began to have that Iscus at work in me, that same spirit that raised Christ from the dead will come and quicken your mortal body. I had a quickening one day. See, I didn't know how I got that quickening until I began to be taught about it. See, I didn't know there had to be something working in me first before I had something working out of me. I had a lot of problems with faith teaching because they're like, just confess the word. I'm like, all right, I'm doing everything I know to do, but I was lacking something. And I began to find out the gaps, filling the gaps of these different things in these chapters that we're going to go through, but just a simple principle, the power of prayer, the power of the word working inside of me. I began to have the dunamis power of God flow. So one day when I had dislocated my shoulder, something rose up in me. I said, I don't care if angels have to come down from heaven to hold my shoulder together. It's just going to work. That glory was released. That power was released. That dunamis power came and held my shoulder together. And it just worked. Because I had been doing something. I didn't know what I was doing. I just knew if I can just read God's word out loud, meditate on it according to what the Bible had told me about what meditation is. If I could just pray in the Spirit for long hours, something was going to happen. Let me tell you, something began to happen. That same Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, who is in me, began to work. Not just in me, because later on, after spending lots of time in prayer, after I began to have my first encounter of healing, my shoulder, I had shared about one of my friends who I began to share about Ephesians 1. If you could just pray this, that God give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, He'll show you. And I began to brag on Jesus all night. And at this time, I was spending hours and hours in the Word and hours in prayer. I was getting that Kratos and Ischus built up in me. I was beginning to learn how to walk in Christ, not just sit in Him, not just have power over my own body and the Spirit of God flowing out, that same Spirit quickened my body. But then one day, my friend said, if you will pray for me in the name of Jesus, and God heals me, I'll believe Him. Because he believed there was a God, but he didn't believe that Jesus was the only way. So I remember sitting there at that time, because at that time I had zero success in praying for anyone. I could say I prayed for someone 1,000 times. I mean, who knew how many of their times I prayed for people? I never knew anybody got healed. And so as I'm sitting there, I said, all right, just a minute. Give me some time to pray. I'm praying in the Spirit. I'm like, Lord, let's be honest here. I'm pretty much 0 for 1,000 if I was going to put it on the board. My winning streak was dire. Wasn't working. But I tapped in on something. And I remember Jesus coming. Because there's something different in the air. There's like the glory of God in that place. And when you can tell the difference, it was like electronic almost. Like the static that was happening. And I've been bragging for 3 hours on Christ. How He's the healer. And how all these different things I've been learning. And then He said, if you will pray for me, not pray that God heal me. You pray that Jesus, you pray in that name. And if He heals me, I'll know He's real. So I'm sitting there and I said, Lord, what do I do? And this was real. Never prayed for anybody and seen them healed. He said, Arian, my power is here to heal. My presence is here to heal. And I just knew, because I was quickened with that word. I was quickened with the word of God, the spoken word in my life. And I just knew that when I lay my hands on Him, He would be healed. Without a shadow of a doubt, I just knew. Laid my hand on Him, and the Lord gave me some words about strengthening His back. And I took my hand off. I didn't feel nothing. I didn't have this like, man, there's electricity that just flowed out of me. Nothing. And I just kind of went over to my corner and was just praying, Lord Jesus, I did what you said. Prayed and I waited. My friend, he actually started cussing. I can't believe it. I can't believe it. And he started doing push-ups, which he wasn't able to do more than a few. He did like 50 something. And he began to say, Jesus is real. He's alive. He said, I told you. So I share that story because that was my process of growth and seeing Christ grow in me through that ischus and kratos. Just spending time praying, just spending time reading the word out loud for months, almost years at that time, watching myself grow and Christ's character grow in me. And I want to close with this. Test it. We're going to go in and find out why, because I had to know why. And once I learned the why, what God was made available to me, it was like this multiplication factor began to happen as I began to pray, as I began to read the Word. And I couldn't understand why everybody else wasn't excited about reading the Word in prayer, meditating on the Word. I didn't know. I was like, man, but I had seen. I had that wisdom and revelation given to me. I prayed that prayer pretty much every day for years. And then God began to show me this process of growth. That's what I want to share. And I pray that God begin to show you, that you begin to test it. You begin to test it. I went from feeling empty and disheartened to feeling strong in the Lord and the power of His might. I begin to see God work. And I pray that God does the same, because He will. It's the Word. God watches over His Word. It never fails. God wants to establish you in Himself. He wants you to be seated with Him in experience in heavenly places in Christ. And these things that we're going to discover in His Word, and if you want to go ahead, I'll give you permission to go ahead and read Ephesus, you know, the book of Ephesians every single day before we get back, you know, if you want to, read it. So that when we get back, we're going to begin to see things. God will begin to show you stuff just from this. Wisdom and revelation is coming. And I believe you've got an impartation tonight. But that spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you. It's quickening your mortal body. That ischus kratos, through that spirit of God, begin to energize you in all these different things. You'll never be the same. Never, never, never. You'll never be the same. Because once you taste it and you see that the Lord is good, you can't turn back. So this is the outline that we're going to go through in these next few months. And so I'm going to go ahead and pray, because God wants to do something even now. So I'm going to pray and I'm going to release a few things, because God wants this to become not just a knowledge, not just something I read about or heard about, but an experience. So Father God, we come to You in the mighty name and the power of the name of Jesus, as sons and daughters of God to You, Father. Father, I'm asking that You would release in a greater measure this spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of You, the eyes of our understanding being enlightened, flooded with light, that we may know the hope of Your calling, the riches of Your glorious inheritance in the saints, Your incomparable great power towards us who believe, that this resurrection life, this resurrection power would dwell in us in such a capacity we will never be the same. We would never be the same. Our Christian walk, our maturity will begin to grow so that we know in whom we trust. We know You. We're seated with You. We experience all that You have given us in heavenly places. Thank You, Father God. Touch us now and those online. Give Him a hunger. Give Him a fervency in prayer to see this at work into them. Give Him a fervency of desire to experience more through Your Word as they get together and they sit with You and they encounter You as You teach them by Your Spirit these things. I thank You, Father. I give You glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I wanted to share one more thing. These three chapters also are what is going to be worked into us. And then these three chapters is what's going to be worked through us to the world. Through us to the world. You're going to see the power of God. And I thank You, Lord, that that the word of God grows mightily and it prevails here in us. So I thank you for watching online, being with us, growing in the word, and we're going to open it up for prayer or for questions after we get off here. And so we're going to meet again Thursday night at 7 p.m. for healing school. And then Friday night at 10 p.m., this coming Friday at 10 p.m. for all night prayer. And then we're also going to have the Sunday service upstairs next time from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. So you're welcome to come with us and watch online. So we're going to go ahead and close. Thank you. And God bless you as you go out. In Jesus' name.